In the last class we had seen the performance of a turbojet. We had derived equations for the non-dimensional thrust as well as we had derived expressions for ISP of a turbojet. Now let's put in some typical numbers and see what is it that we get out of it, and we'll see some interesting facets of it. Okay. So firstly we'll look at optimal expansion of flow. The nozzle. Here there are two conditions that we need to look at. One is sea level thrust or sea level ISP and what happens at cruise conditions. So at sea level P naught is equal to one atmosphere or 0.1 megapascals, and T naught would be, if we assume an ISA atmosphere model, then it will be 288 Kelvin. And M naught is 0 at sea level before takeoff conditions. And now if we assume the compression ratio pi c to be very low, that is pi c to be of the order of around 4, then my tau c would be something like 1.484, and if we take TT4 to be 1000 Kelvin, then this makes theta b is equal to something like 3.4, and we know the Q of the fuel, this is kerosene, so 42 megajoules per kg, and let us take the Cp of air and flue gases to be the same, and let us take it to be 1 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. So with this conditions, now you have to find out what is it at the cruise altitude of around 11 kilometers. So altitude, what are the things that are going to change? The things that are going to change are these two only, atmospheric conditions, and at cruise conditions this Mach number will also change. So we need to change the only three parameters, P naught would be lower and it would be somewhere around 22.6 kilopascals, and T naught would be ISA, International Standard Atmosphere. So therefore we get this. Now if we use this and calculate F by M dot A naught and ISP, okay, we have all the parameters here to calculate both of them. We will get this kind of a table. m naught is equal to 0, then I'll also put V7 V0, both these in meters per second, and lastly ISP in kilonewton second per kg. Okay. So if we take the sea level performance, that is at sea level, m naught is equal to 0, and using this we will get f by m dot a naught as 1.8, and this would be something like 612 meters per second, and this would be 0, and ISP would be something like this. Now at 11 kilometers m naught would be 0.8, and this would reduce slightly to 1.76, Now there are two things to notice. One is that irrespective of the altitude, you see that f by m dot a naught is nearly constant, right. This happens because of two things. One, notice that at sea level this is large, the velocity differential is large, okay. The mass flow rate is very small, velocity differential is large, mass flow rate is very small, so you end up getting a high thrust because of the velocity differential. At a higher altitude the velocity differential is reduced, but you have air coming in now at this velocity, therefore what you get is a larger mass flow rate. So you get a larger mass flow rate with a smaller velocity differential, therefore you get nearly the same thrust or same non-dimensional thrust. What happens to ISP? ISP has come down, which means that SFC has gone up. If I were to write SFC also here, SFC would be in kg per kgr, this would be something like 0.8. This would be like 1.06. So we are cruising at an altitude wherein the SFC is low. Why do we do that? I think it would be more beneficial if we were to stay on ground or close to ground and carry out our operations, isn't that? From the looks of it, what we see is that the ISP has come down or SFC has increased. So why do you think if this is happening, or this is desirable, not desirable, what is the opinion? You have one, say something. No? Huh? So what happens?
SFC increases.
No, not really. Well, actually the reason why we operate it at a higher altitude is primarily the drag is less at a higher altitude, right. You are not looking at drag of the engine per se, you are looking at the drag of the entire aircraft, wherein when I was discussing about turbofan engines, I said GE goes in for a bypass ratio of 9 and says that the engine or the nacelle drag is very small compared to the overall drag, and therefore they go in for a large bypass ratio, right. Now what we are looking at is the drag of the entire aircraft goes down as altitude increases, because rho decreases as you go up in altitude, right. Now density decreases, drag decreases, but your SFC will increase, because what we have set in here is, if you notice, I did not change this part, TT4. TT4 is the same at both the altitudes, and if you look at theta b, in this case theta b would be, because T naught is lower, so theta b for TT4 of equal to 1000 Kelvin would be 4.63. That is, what we are saying is you need more fuel to bring the air from a lower temperature after compression to 1000 Kelvin, because we have set that temperature. So therefore we will find that the SFC will be higher, right, okay, and that is the reason we see this. Now we can look at similar numbers for choke flow through the nozzle. The only thing that changes would be, I will just put them here itself. Now here we will assume a slightly larger compression ratio of around 12, which means that tau c would also go up, it would be this much. We can also increase the turbine inlet temperature, and this means theta b will go up to 100 Kelvin here, and you are not pointed it out, it was to be 1000 Kelvin earlier, and that makes it 4.63, okay. And that is why we saw that change in ISP or SFC. Now if we change it to 1200 Kelvin, theta b would be 5.55, and this would mean correspondingly all these quantities will change. Because now we have choke flow in the nozzle, the thrust consists of two parts, one is the convective flux part and the pressure thrust part. So this will again have two parts, and at an altitude this is what we see. Notice that as you go up in altitude the fraction of the pressure thrust is increasing, okay. It is a lower fraction here, right, or if you look at this number it is a lower fraction here compared to a higher fraction here, right, the overall thrust. Why does this happen? Why does pressure thrust part increase as you go up in altitude? Ambient pressure, if you see, is 1/5, so the pressure thrust part is going to increase if you go up in altitude, okay. And again you see the same feature here that SFC has increased, and that is primarily because you need to heat the air from a lower temperature to a set temperature of 1200 here instead of 1000 earlier. So therefore you will find that SFC is higher in this case, okay, fine. Okay, then we have dealt with two things. We have looked at optimally expanded flow through the nozzle, and we have looked at choke nozzle, okay. Now let us look at what happens if you have the afterburner on and the other method of increasing the thrust, that is water methanol injection. Let us look at these two methods and how to derive expressions for them, okay. So firstly let us look at what happens if we have the afterburner on. I will retain these set of numbers because I want to use this to look at what happens without the afterburner with the afterburner conditions. So I will retain this numbers and we will get back to a similar table at the end of the discussion on afterburners. Now if we look at the TS diagram with the afterburner on, we will again assume eta to be 1, okay. So you have isentropic compression through the intake as well as through the compressor, then you have heat addition in the main combustor, expansion through the turbine, so this is 0, 2, 2, okay. So this is the TS diagram for efficiencies 1 and with the afterburner. Switch on. Okay. Now, what do we have to do if we have to analyze this? Okay. Firstly, our expression for f by m dot a naught, the non-dimensional thrust would be m naught into, in this case, 1 plus f plus, I'll introduce a new parameter FAB, M7 by M naught into under root T7 by, right. This is the expression for non-dimensional thrust. Now, if you put FAB equal to 0, this is the expression that we had derived for a turbojet without the afterburner switched on, right. When FAB goes to 0, this is the expression that we get. Now, we have FAB, where FAB is nothing but m dot fuel that is added in the afterburner divided by m dot air. Okay. So, it is the fuel air ratio in the afterburner. So, what do you think of the value of this plus this? What is the maximum of F and F plus AB that it can go to? It can maximum go to stoichiometric, which is, what is the value? It is 0.067, which is the stoichiometric value. You cannot burn more than that. So, it goes to something like 0.067. Now, if you go to 0.067, I can still use the condition that F plus FAB is less than 1, right, with an error of around 6.7%. So, I will use that. I will say F plus FAB is very much less than 1, okay. So, that we can take this terms off, and I will also introduce another parameter here. Just like we had TT4 by T naught as a controlled parameter, we have a new control parameter that is TT6 by T naught, right. What is the maximum temperature in the cycle divided by T naught, the minimum temperature. So, I will call TT6 by T naught as equal to theta AB. Remember, we had TT4 by T naught as equal to theta burner. Similar to that, I am introducing a new control parameter to account for the afterburner. Okay. So, using this, I need still these ratios T7 by T naught and M7 by M naught. So, I can get T7 by T naught as TT7 into TT6 by, okay. This has to be TT6. Okay, fine. These two cancel off, and I'll get T7 by T naught. What is T7 by TT7? It is the ratio of static to stagnation. So I can express this in terms of Mach number. This would be 1 by 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 M7 square. What is T7 by TT7 by TT6? This is flow through the nozzle, right. So flow through the nozzle, we have assumed the flow to be isentropic. So TT, the total temperature does not change. So this is 1, and TT6 by TT0, we have defined it as theta AB. So I get T7 by T0 as equal to theta AB by M7 square. Now we need to do cascading of pressures to get the other parameter.
In case of afterburner,
yes.
The nozzle will be choked always. Huh? Nozzle will be always choked.
Yes. True.
So why are we doing for the optimal? Because in case of
even in optimally expanded, if you use a convergent nozzle, it's still choked. We will do both cases. Okay. Firstly, we'll take the optimal expanded flow. Then we'll look at what happens if the nozzle is choked. The nozzle being choked doesn't essentially mean that P7 is equal to P0. It can be that P7 is greater than P0 even if the nozzle is choked, right. So we are taking a special case of choke flow wherein the exit pressure is equal to the ambient pressure. Now if we do cascading of pressures, I get P7 by P0 is equal to this is what we get, and the first term here is ratio, again ratio of static to stagnation pressure. This is flow through nozzle, flow through jet pipe, and then flow through turbine, flow through the main combustor, flow through compressor, and this would be flow through intake, and that is theta naught to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1. So we will put that down here. And we know, because we are considering optimally expanded flow, what is P7 by P0? This would be equal to unity. So we will use that. So we can write 1 is equal to 1 by M7 square into flow through nozzles, we are assuming all efficiencies to be 1, then flow through afterburner again 1, then flow through compressor, you get phi t, then sorry, flow through turbine, then you have flow through combustor which is 1, then you have flow through compressor phi c, and you have flow through the intake which is 1, and lastly theta naught to the power of gamma by gamma minus 1, and here also sorry. So I get, I can rewrite these two in terms of tau t, so I will get 1 is equal to 1 by or 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m 7 square is equal to tau t tau c theta naught, okay. And I know from the definition of theta naught that 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m naught square is equal to theta naught. So using these two I can get my expression for m 7 by m naught. So I can write M7 as equal to 2 by gamma minus 1 tau t tau c theta naught minus 1, and M0 similarly would be 1. And we required in our expression for T7 by T0 this term, so I can get that too. So I can write T7 by T0 as equal to 0 AB by tau T tau C theta naught minus 1. Okay, so sorry, no minus 1, sorry. So this is the expression that we have. Now we can substitute back and get our expression for the non-dimensional thrust, which is F by m dot a naught is equal to or I minus, I can rewrite this part by taking this out as common. I can rewrite this as So this is the expression that we get for the non-dimensional thrust. Now there is still one part missing. We know that there is a turbine compressor power balance. So these two are not independent variables and they are connected, okay. So let us get that expression also. We had derived that expression for a case without the afterburner on. Do you think it will change with the afterburner being switched on? Because this is something that, that happens downstream of the turbine, it does not get affected and therefore whatever we had derived earlier holds good. So from we get tau t is equal to 1 minus theta naught by theta b into tau c minus 1, and if you substitute this expression back then we will get f by this is the overall expression that we get. Notice here that theta b is now a parameter of very small consequence, right. The temperature at the end of the combustor is not such an important parameter, whereas for the thrust the temperature at the end of the afterburner is a more important parameter. Now let us look also at the ISP part, okay. If we have to calculate ISP, we know from our previous expression for non-dimensional specific impulse that I need 1 by f into f by m dot a naught. So here this was the expression that we had without the afterburner. How would this change with the afterburner? I need to include here f plus fab for the case with the afterburner, okay. So with the afterburner on you have this additional term here, okay. Now how do we determine this quantity? How do we determine this quantity? What do we need to do? What did we do to get 1 by f? Energy balance across the combustor. Now what do we need to do? Energy balance across the combustor plus the afterburner. So let us do that. by taking energy afterburner, we get m dot f plus m dot f a b into q, okay, must be equal to m dot a into 1 plus f c p t t 4 minus TT3 plus m dot a into 1 plus f plus FAB, okay. This is the portion that gets added on in the afterburner into CP TT 6 by minus TT5. Okay, this is the expression that we get. Now we know that we can use f is very much less than 1, and we also know that f plus FAB is also very much less than 1. So using this I can eliminate these two, and therefore I will get f plus FAB, that is you take it here and divide this by m dot a, you will get this into q by CP must be equal to TT6 minus TT5 plus TT4 minus TT3. Okay. Now, if we look at the TS diagram, if we look at the TS diagram, this is the TS diagram we have, and what we have here is TT6 minus TT5, that is this minus this, plus TT4 minus TT3, fine. Now I can add this part, what you will get is you will get as though it is a continuous rise from TT3 to TT6, okay. If I add this part, but we know that compressor turbine power balance CP being the same, this portion and this portion is same, so you have to subtract one of them. If you are adding this, you have to subtract this, okay. And I also know that the TT2 must be equal to TT0, right, because flow through the, what do you have, flow through the intake. What kind of process is that? It is an isentropic process, because we are assuming all efficiencies to be 1, it is an isentropic process, total temperature does not change. Okay. So you get TT2 is equal to TT0. So we will use that here and do a little bit of jugglery. As I said, I will add minus TT5 minus TT4 minus okay. If you look at this, I have not done anything. This is, what is this part? Turbine, work in the turbine, work in the compressor, these two must be equal, right. So I can take this out, these two are equal. Now I know that TT2 by TT0 is equal to 1, so this goes to 0, okay. So by doing this manipulation I have been able to get this as TT6 minus TT0, which is nothing but you are looking at raising the temperature from here to TT6, okay. Sorry, this was TS diagram. So so I can write now F plus FAB Q by CP is equal to TT6 by minus TT0. Now if I divide by T0 on both sides, I get what is TT6 by T0? This is theta AB and what is this? This is theta0. So we get a new expression for, we are looking for this expression 1 by F plus FAB is equal to Q by CP T0 theta AB minus theta0, okay. And following this I can now write ISP by A0 is equal to Q by CP T0 theta AB minus theta0 into okay. So this is our expression for ISP with the afterburner switched on. I will stop here and continue.